What's your favorite species of parasite?
Let me think for a minute. It's kind of like asking to choose between your children. Like, they're all important.
There's, you know, space to explore, there's the deep ocean. That's for suckers, you know. Parasites are just this untapped frontier of we don't know.
We're really just scratching the surface to understand the critical role parasites may play.
At this point, it would take more than 500 years to describe what we estimate to be out there.
They're everywhere. They're this kind of silent force in ecosystems. What we found was it looks pretty bad for parasites. What if we actually took this seriously and we did this the way we do conservation for everything else? What if we save the parasites?
This is a tapeworm from a human, from a person, that was collected in 1939. And by the looks of the jar, it hasn't been opened in quite a while. This is all one worm. It's about 12 feet. And the label said it was passed spontaneously without medication. My name is Anna Phillips. I am a research zoologist and curator at the National Museum of Natural History. These are the research collections with the National Parasite Collection. This is a part of the museum that the public doesn't necessarily get to see. These are chunks of tissue, but underneath you can kind of see the worms. These are nematodes, and they're from a porpoise from the Albatross research vessel. This was collected in 1887. It's still a good research specimen.
Parasite is more of a verb than a noun. There are parasitic animals, there are parasitic plants and fungi. It's a really convenient strategy if you can get it right. So parasitism isn't about being a particular kind of thing. It's about cheating the system, right? It's about living at the expense of a host. My name is Colin Carlson. I am a global change biologist, so I think about what life on this planet will look like in the future. There are parasites in every creature around us. There are parasites in every species on Earth.
Parasitism it's more of a lifestyle than a taxonomic group. Parasitism has evolved multiple times in the tree of life, but in the scope of parasite diversity, the number that infect or infest humans is actually quite small compared to the vast number that are infecting wildlife.
A very small percent of species can infect us. A very small percent of species are responsible for the majority of the global burden of disease. We gotta get rid of those. We gotta do something about that, right? That goal does not change if we start to think about parasite conservation, because those are probably not the species that are holding ecosystems together.
Many parasites, especially parasitic worms, have complex life cycles that involve multiple hosts that they have to enter in the correct order and at the right time in order to complete that life cycle to reproduce. If the parasite is completing its life cycle, it shows that those host animals have been playing that role in the ecosystem for a long period of time. And it's an indicator of ecosystem health and stability.
Lemurs are an incredibly important case study, not only for studying primate-parasite interactions, but also just conservation in general. We often refer to parasites as being on kind of a spectrum from being a very specialized parasite, meaning that it only infects maybe one or two host species, to being a generalist, meaning it can infect multiple. So when you think about the lemurs of Madagascar, you know, they arrived in an isolated island probably 60 million years ago, and their lice and mites have been evolving along with them all that time. So they're just as unique as those lemurs are, so are their mites. I'm James Herrera. I'm the program coordinator here at the Duke Lemur Center, and specifically the SAVA Conservation Initiative. They're among the most threatened mammals in the world. There are a number of pressures on their natural habitats that are causing their populations to shrink, and so this is potentially going to be throwing off those balances between the hosts and their parasites. So we can create this kind of matrix where we understand which hosts are infected by which parasites, and then from there, we create the network. I started to think about it kind of in terms of that kid's game called Kerplunk, you know, where you've got all those sticks that are holding up the marbles, and you start to pull the sticks out, and one or two doesn't really seem to make a difference, but as you start to pull out those really critical sticks, all of a sudden, all the marbles could just totally fall at once. And I thought to myself, well, could that be what happens with the primate parasite network? If we start by removing those really well-connected hosts, we see that the secondary extinctions of parasites would increase very rapidly.
This is a species of worm that's adapted host is actually the possum. It has a life cycle that requires an intermediate host, and in our case, it's cockroaches, and our lemurs love to eat the cockroaches. So when they eat cockroaches, they get stomach worms.
It seems odd to think about, you know, worrying about parasite extinctions. However, because these organisms have evolved together for millions of years, we really just don't know what the effects would be of losing those parasite connections.
They're this kind of dark matter. They move energy around and they connect species that otherwise have no connection, and all of that holds ecosystems together.
These are your hosts.
We started thinking, okay, well, what does the data tell us about how parasites go extinct, about whether they're vulnerable to climate change? And it turned out people hadn't thought about it a lot. Parasites sort of face this double jeopardy. There are two ways a parasite can go extinct. Up to the point where we started doing our research, the big one people talked about was co-extinction. So your host is gone, you're out of the game. But parasites are also directly vulnerable to the environment. With parasites, the biggest data source we have is collections. It's data that you can hold in your hand.
In this study, we brought together data from multiple museum collections for parasites.
What they didn't have was coordinates attached to them, because 90% of that data is from before handheld GPS. And so what we did was we tried to figure out what we could go back and very easily assign coordinates to.
And that meant that we could take a very large view to predict the extinction risk of parasites in changing climate scenarios.
We took each of those parasite species, we simulated the kind of environment they need to live in, so what temperature, what rainfall. We map that, and then we look at where that would go in a changing climate. We know the probability that parasites go extinct from climate change, but we also know the probability their hosts go extinct. And that lets us get at that issue of double jeopardy. What we found is that about probably 1 in 10 parasites faces extinction risk from climate change over the next 50 or so years. That number, if you account for the fact that many of their hosts are threatened, probably closer to 1 in 3 parasites. And that is a really alarmingly high extinction rate. That is a level of extinction that would take hundreds of years to get in some groups. We are talking about hundreds of thousands of parasitic worms of vertebrates. We're talking about 80 million potential parasites of arthropods, and you're talking about a third of them vanishing. We have no idea what that would do to ecosystems. And so what we wrote about was an idea. What if we looked around the world and we all worked together and we tried to describe, you know, half the parasitic diversity on Earth?
The Global Parasite Project is a call to action to document the parasites in the world. If we could create a moonshot for parasites, the leaps and bounds of knowledge that we could cross in a time frame, even 5 to 10 years, would be revolutionary to knowledge in the field. It's important to document it now because these changes are happening faster than ever. This needs to be a truly global effort.
We wanted the data to live somewhere. We built something called the Parasite Extinction Assessment and Red List, or PEARL. There's about 450 species of parasite in there, and what it really is just a set of maps. Here's where the parasites are today, here's where we think they could be in the future, and here's some information on their hosts. It's a monument to, we could do this if we cared about it.
Obviously, the world knows that there's a lot of research that still needs to be done with viruses, and we feel the same way about parasites.
You know, there's no way to stand at the computer like Nick Fury and be like, okay, show me a world map and show me every gopher, and then only show me the gophers that have ticks, right? But what if we could? There's so much data from nature, And so that's kind of where we're headed.
These parasites are species just like any other on the planet that have been evolving for millions of years, and so in many ways they have just as much right to exist as the tigers and the pandas.
As a scientific community, we're asking all these really big questions about the future, and barely ever are we thinking about what parasites are doing in that system. We're so many steps back from actually having these answers that we're guessing about what the important questions are, right? That's never a situation you want to find yourself in when you're talking about a changing planet.